Good evening. I'm here to recite the Beat Boys. Now, I'm one of these people who believe that poetry, like medicine, should be taken in small doses. So I'm just going to do 4 poems. From my book, Selected Poems, published by Penguin. And the book is divided into 3 sections, 70s verse, 80s verse, 90s verse. I'm going to do 2 from the 70s, 1 from the 80s, 1 from the 90s. Now, a lot has been said about gun and knife crime among the youth, black youth in particular, and gangs and so on. But we need to look at these things in historical perspective. Because when I look back on my own youth, I can't see anything much different from what's going on today. The only thing is that we didn't have the amount of guns available that young people seem to have available to them nowadays. And the world that I grew up in as a youth was not the kind of world dominated by the consumerist ethos and the pursuit of material goods driven by the revolution in new technologies. I'm going to recite a poem for you that explains what I'm talking about. It's called Five Nights of Bleeding, and I wrote it in 1972. Madness, madness, madness tied on the heads of the rebels. The bitterness erupts like a hot glass, broke glass. Rituals of blood on the burning, served by the crowing fighting. 5 nights of horror on the bleeding, broke glass. Cold blades as sharp as the eyes of hate and the stabbings. It's war amongst the rebels. Madness, madness, war. Night number 1 was in Brixton. Soprano B sound system was a beating out a rhythm with a fire. Coming down is reggae, reggae wire. It was a sound shaking down your spinal column. A bad music tearing up your flesh. And the rebels then start a fighting. The youth then just turn wild. It's war amongst the rebels. Madness, madness, war. Night number 2 down at Shepherd's, right up Railton Road. It was a night named Friday when everyone was high on brew or drew a pound or 2 worth of Cali. Sound coming down Neville King's music iron. The rhythm just bubbling and backfiring, raging and rising when suddenly the music cut. Steeply drinking blood in darkness. It's war amongst the rebels. Madness, madness, war. Night number 3, over the river, right outside the rainbow. Inside, James Brown was screaming soul. Outside, the rebels were freezing cold. Babylonian tyrants descended, pounced on the brothers who were bold. So with a flick of the wrist, a jab and a stab, the song of blades was sounded. The bile of oppression was vomited, and 2 policemen wounded. Righteous, righteous war. Night number 4 at a blues dance. 2 rooms packed and the pressure pushing up, hot, hot heads. Rituals of blood in a blues dance. Broke glass, splintering fire, axes, blades, brain glass. Rebellion rushing down the wrong road, storm going down the wrong tree. And Leroy pleads near death on the 4th night in a blues dance on a black rebellious night. It's war amongst the rebels, madness, madness, war. Night number 5 at the Telegraph. Vengeance walked through the doors and so slow, so smooth, so tight and ripe and smash. bonfires ahead and the shell of the fire heard cracks. The victim feels fear, hides hands, holds knife, finds throat. Oh, the stabbings and the bleeding and the blood. It's war amongst the rebels. Madness, madness, war. Now, the black people of Nigeria. I belong to what I call the rebel generation. We refused to tolerate the things our parents tolerated when they came to this country in the 50s and in the early 60s. And through our rebellion, we helped to make this country a little bit of a better place. A significant section of my generation were criminalized by racist police officers. And invariably would be arrested and charged with attempting to steal from persons unknown. Your alleged victim was never produced in court to give evidence against you. As long as the police officer was able to convince the magistrate that he had reasonable grounds to believe that you intended to commit the crime, that was all that was required to obtain a conviction. Now people get confused between the law under which we were criminalized in those days and stop and search. This is not stop and search, it was sus. Sus being short for suspicion. And if the police were suspicious about you or said that you were behaving suspiciously, you could find yourself in jail. Now, the sus law was in fact a piece of 19th century legislation called the Vagrancy Act, which was used to control the movements of the unemployed during the Victorian era. It had been dormant on the statute books until the youth of my generation emerged on the scene, whereupon it was suddenly rediscovered and used against us. So during the 70s, there was a political campaign to get rid of this law, and I contributed this poem to the campaign, and it takes the form of a letter from a prison in England, just from somewhere in the Caribbean. It's called Sonny's Letter. Bridgetown Prison, Jeb Avenue, London Southwest 2, England. Dear Mama, good day. I hope that when these few lines reach you, they may find you the best of them. Mama, I really don't know how to tell you this, cause I did make a solemn promise to take care of little Jim and try my best to look out for him. Mama, I really did try my best, but nonetheless, me sorry to tell you, sir, poor little Jim get a rest. It was the middle of the rush hour, when everybody just a hustle and a bustle to go home for the evening shower. Me and Jim stand up waiting for the bus, not causing no fuss, when all of a sudden, a policeman pull up. Out jump three policemen, the whole of them carrying baton. Them walk straight up to me and Jim. One of them went on to Jim, saying, take him in. Jim tell him to let go of him, for him not nothing, and him not a thief, not even a button. When Jim start to wriggle, the police start to giggle. Mama, they can't tell you what them do to Jim. Mama, they can't tell you what them do to him. Them thumped him in his belly and he turned to jelly. Them lick him on his back and he really dead pop. Them lick him on his head, but he tough like leg. Them kick him in his seed and he started to bleed. Mama, I just couldn't stand up there and I do nothing. So he took one in his eye and he started to cry. He took one in his mouth and he started to shout. He kicked one on his chin and he started to spin. He thumped him on his chin and he dropped on a bin and crashed. And then, Mama, more policemen come down and beat me to the ground. Them charged him for sus. Them charged me for murder. Mama, don't fret. Don't get depressed and down on you. Be of good courage till I hear from you. I remain your son, son. The year 1981 is the most significant in the history of the post-World War II black experience in Britain. In January of that year, Yvonne Rodham was celebrating her 16th birthday at 439 New Cross Road when some racists, some fascists, threw an incendiary device through the window of the house, which resulted in a fire. In that fire, 13 young blacks lost their lives. 26 were seriously injured. There were no messages of condolence from the Queen. There were no messages of condolence from the Prime Minister. The black communities mobilized themselves to do something about it and formed the New Cross Massacre Action Committee. It was the police themselves who informed Mrs. Ruddock, Yvonne's mother, that it had been an arson attack. And such acts were not unprecedented. They've been going on from the 70s. But within less than 48 hours, the police, without carrying out any forensic investigation, the police ruled out of hand completely the possibility that it could have been a racist arson attack. Well, the New Cross Massacre Action Committee planned a big march to protest the death of those young people and the way the matter had been handled by the authorities. And on the 3rd of March, 1981, in spite of lies and propaganda by the press and the police to imply that it was black-on-black violence that started the fire, 20,000 people marched through London. 20,000 people marched through London to Hyde Park to protest the death of those young people. That was known as the Black People's Day of Action. And it was after that march and the riots that happened after that that the British establishment began to take note of the fact that black people in this country had some power and were prepared to use that power. One month after the Black People's Day of Action, in my own local community in Brixton, South London, the police launched an operation called Operation Swamp 81, where they went about stopping and searching, harassing and intimidating black people going about their everyday lawful business. But that was the straw that broke the camel's back, and we had a riot, which I describe in this poem called The Great Insurrection. It was in April 1981, down in the ghetto of Brixton, that the Babylon had caused such a friction that it bring about a great insurrection. And it spread all over the nation. It was surely an historical occasion. It was the event of the year, and I wish I had been there when we run riot all over Brixton, when we mash up the police van, when we mash up the wicked one plan. When we mash up the Swamp 81, say what? They make the rule of them understand that we not take no more of them oppression. And when they check out the ghetto grapevine, they find out all they could have find. Every rebel just a rebel in them story. Them a talk about the power and the glory. Them a talk about the burning and the looting. Them a talk about the smashing and the grabbing. Them a tell them about the vanquish and the victory. Them said the Babylon them went too far. So we had was the bond to care. And one or two innocent get marred. But what? Now so it was sometime in a war, Easter. Now so it was sometime in a war. Them said we burn down the judge, we could have burn the landlord. We burn down the judge, we never burn the landlord. When we run riot all over Brixton, when we mash up the police van, when we mash up the wicked one plan, when we mash up the Swamp 81. Them said we come and we care and we gather ammunition, we build the barricade and the wicked catch up for it. We send out, we scout, we go find them, we run out, when we farm up, we pass here, we make we real. But now everyone got no plan to counteract. action. But the plastic bullet and the water cannon, we bring a damn down, we bring a damn down. Never mind scar, man, we bring a damn down. Now, towards the end of the 1980s, at a time when the old world order had collapsed and the new one was yet to come into being, there were a number of acts of barbarism in various parts of Europe, Eastern Africa, and the Middle East. And the media coined some new term to describe these new acts of barbarism. And the term they came up with was the term ethnic cleansing. Now, I find this term to be profoundly disturbing, because for one to talk about ethnic cleansing, to my simple way of thinking, that presupposes the notion of ethnic purity. Now, we have to be very careful about how we use language, because we not only negotiate our everyday reality through language, more importantly, we define our humanity through language. And for me, the term ethnic cleansing represents the dehumanization of language and the language of dehumanization. So I wrote a poem about it, and I call it New World Art. I know it by heart, but just in case I flap my hands. Oh, here we go. The killers and killers must be sanitary workers. The butchers and butchers must be sanitary workers. The savages of Chattila must be sanitary workers. The beasts of Bosnia must be sanitary workers. In a new world, like a dirty old bandage on the festering face of humanity, the old order unravel and reveal old scars that broke out in a new sore. Primeval wound that time won't heal, and in the ancient currency of blood, tribal tyrants are second world score. The killers of Kigali must be sanitary workers. The butchers of Bukari must be sanitary workers. The savages of Chattila must be sanitary workers. The beasts of Bosnia must be sanitary workers. In a new world order. And it's the same old Cain and Abel syndrome, far more ancient than the father of Rome. But in the new world order of atrocity, is a brand new language of barbarity. Mass murder, normalized, pogrom, rationalized, genocide, sanitized, and the ancient cleansing. No name ethnic cleansing. And so the killers of Kigali must be sanitary workers. The butchers of Butari must be sanitary workers. The savages of Chattila must be sanitary workers. The beasts of Bosnia must be sanitary workers. Pram, pram, pram. In a new world order. Thank you very much. That's very kind of you. Now, some time ago, someone brought it to my attention that my name was mentioned in the Oxford Companion to 20th Century Poetry. Albeit as a footnote. And my name was mentioned in the context of a definition of dumb poetry. And they quoted someone as describing a saying that dumb poetry is overcompensation for deprivation, unquote. I couldn't take that line down, could I? So by way of riposte, I wrote this piece, and I make reference to Buthelezi. Some of you are too young to know who Buthelezi is. Buthelezi is the chief of the Zulus, who was a collaborator with the apartheid regime in South Africa and a thorn in Nelson Mandela's ANC. I also make reference to Lance Percival. Lance Percival was a very popular English comic actor who also made a name for himself doing parodies of well-known calypsos. So by way of repost to the Oxford Companion's quotation, I wrote this piece called If I Was a Top-Notch Poet. If I was a top-notch poet, like you saw Kit Bump, Derek Walcott, or T.S. Eliot,
yo,
I would write a poem so damn deep that it bittersweet. Like a precious memory, we make you weep, we make you feel incomplete. Like when you love a leaf, and do what you feel you can see, till you beg and you plead, till you win and reprieve, and you're ready to rap, still, what you need is done already. Still, in the meantime, with me rhythm, with me rhyme, with me rough bass line, with me own sense of time, both poet and me step in line. Now put a lazy might have got a couple thousand, but man, they are feeling thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands. If I was a top-notch poet, like Carl Brathwaite, Martin Carter, Jane Cortez, or Amiri Baraka, I would write a poem so rude and rootsy and subversive that it makes the good poet turn white red. Like a condom, the voodoo, come in a chant, a old time calypso or a slave song that get banned. But from Grand Pitney right down, from Granny right down to Grand Pitney, each and every one can recite that one. Still, in the meantime, with me rhythm, with me rhyme, with me rough bass line, with me own sense of time, own point of the step in line. Caputa lazy might have got a couple thousand, but man, there are been thousands and thousands and thousands. If I was a top-notch poet, like Chikaya Yotamsi, Nicholas Owen, or Lana Woodison, I would write a poem so beautiful that is simple, like a plain girl, with good brains and nice ways, with a sexy disposition and plenty compassion, with a sweet smile and a certain style. Still, me not a bow and scrape and go on like a ear, peddling up purine parchment and ethnicity, with hunger and beer, fleeting in the authenticity, like a black man's Percival in reverse, or even worse, a babbling buffoon when losing tongue. No, sir. Not at all. Me got the rhythm, me got the rhyme, me got the rough bass line, me got the one sense of time. Boon poet of the step in line. Caputa lazy man got a couple thousand. But man, there are thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands. You're wonderful, thank you.